各位朋友，你们好，这里是美国波士顿地区的关注学术使命平台，感谢参加我们今天的学术讲座。我是主持人 Steven，今天是美国东部时间2024年11月30号礼拜六上午的9点，即北京时间礼拜六晚上的10点。本学术平台持非常保守的基督教立场和右派的政治立场，当前事工的主要任务是，在学术层面继承、发展并构建基督教保守主义的学术思想体系，在教会和基督徒当中推广学术使命和教育使命的概念意识。如果未来有任何朋友希望参加我们的公开讲座，请在留言区留下您的电子邮件，您将会收到我们的讲座通知和一些学术资料。今天我们十分荣幸邀请到斯蒂拉·普莱斯女士为大家带来讲座《朝鲜基督教历史简介》。斯蒂拉·普莱斯，理学学士，教学硕士，于20年前开始研究朝鲜，撰写了《为朝鲜半岛蒙拣选呼召》、《宣教殉道的罗伯特·托马斯·崔兰轩》一书。讲述了1866年在朝鲜殉道的新教传教士罗伯特·托马斯的生平，他还撰写了宣教士金正庆的生平。金正庆曾在中国和朝鲜创办大学，他的著作现已被威尔士国家图书馆收藏，并被翻译成中文和韩文。本讲座分为两部分，第一部分是主题内容，第二部分是讨论与问答时间。
Do you want me to begin?
厉害，你没有那个开麦
Oh,
，sorry。
yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah, thank you, Stephen. We are very pleased to have Stella with us today and introducing her experience and studies in North Korea to about the missionaries. So, Stella, thank you for joining us here.
Thank you. So shall we begin then? I have some slides here, and I wanted to let you know that very important when we discuss the Christian history of Korea, we need to understand that it's inextricably linked with China. And it begins in the 16th and 17th centuries when the Catholic Church made a connection with Korea. And in particular, a scholar named Yi Sun Hun.
好的。当我们谈到韩国基督教历史的时候呢，我们需要明白，这段历史呢与中国有着千丝万缕之的联系。韩国基督教历史呢始于16世纪的天主教的宣教士，17世纪是当时的一些学者吧，宣教士，他们呢吸引了一些韩国的和中国的知识分子。Stella, before I translate, please don't to go to the next page. I need to watch your slide.
I see. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm
And
done now.
you're finished.
Yeah.
So this scholar, Yi Sun Hun, traveled from Korea to Beijing as part of the annual tribute delegation. He secretly came to seek out a Catholic priest and receive baptism because he wanted to live out what he had read. And he returned to Korea in that time with a chest full of Christian books, crucifixes, and other Christian items. He was able to convince his father of the truth of Christ, and they started the first church in Korea. This is the Catholic Church, turning their home into a meeting place for interested scholars. And when the first priest in Korea, a Chinese, Zhu Wenmiao, arrived a decade later. He estimated that 4,000 people had embraced the faith.
好的，其中有一位到达中国学习啊新知识的啊，学习这种西方包括基督教知识的韩国的年轻学者叫李承铉啊，1784年的时候呢，他作为朝鲜向中国年度进贡的代表团到达北京，到达北京后呢，他秘密的找到了一位天主教的神父，并接受了洗礼，他想实践呢他以前曾经读到过的基督教的知识和信仰，于是呢，他带着满满一箱子基督教书籍，十字架等等的圣品圣物，回到朝鲜，他还说服了自己的父亲，也接受了基督教信仰，于是呢，他们在韩国建立了第一座教堂，把他们的家呢变成了什么？对基督教有兴趣的学者的聚会的地点，这是1784年，就是他到北京之后的事情，后来回去1784年之后，所以在这之后的10年里呢，基督教在朝鲜发展，10年后也就是1884年大约，韩国的第一位神父，也就是朝鲜的第一位神父，天主教神父了。这位神父呢，是一位中国人，应该就是天主教派过去的。这位中国人叫朱文苗，所以他当到达朝鲜的时候呢，他估计当时朝鲜已经有4000人接受了是基督徒，也就是说是天主教徒。
Confucianism has shaped ideas about education in Korea. The glue holding the traditional nobility together was education, which meant socialization into Confucian norms and virtues. And this began in early childhood and with the reading of the extraordinarily difficult classical Chinese language. Which I expect all Chinese probably know. And throughout the Joseon dynasty, all official records were in the Chinese language. And most written discourse was also in classical Chinese. And with Chinese language and philosophy came a profound cultural penetration of Korea. Such that most Joseon arts and literature came to use Chinese models. Now, the Hangul system was developed later by Sejong, fourth king of the Joseon dynasty, in 1443 to improve literacy. And in 1446, Hangul was made the official writing system of Korea, but despite this, the Hanja, the Chinese characters, persisted as the main system of the elite class for 500 years.
好的，我们需要明白的是，中国的儒家思想塑造了韩国的教育理念，韩国人的教育理念，将韩国的传统贵族紧密联系在一起的是教育，也就是这种教育呢，从儿童开始呢，韩国人就开始阅读儒家经典，从而将他们的新一代呢融入儒家的规范和美德之中。韩国的教育起步很早，韩国学生呢必须要掌握极其困难的古典汉语，要背诵记忆那成千上万的汉字。文字及其表达的含义，在整个朝鲜王国期间，也就是1392年到1897年，将近500年，所有的官方政府记录、正规教育和大多数书面话语，书面文字都是用古典汉语书写的。也就是说呢，中国的语言和中国的这种传统哲学传统文化文明，对韩国的文化渗透非常深远。大多数的朝鲜艺术和文学呢，当时都采用了中国模式。那么到了1443年呢， 朝鲜王国的第四任国王，世宗，他为了提高民众的认字率、识字率，开发了韩语的系统，韩国，开发了就是朝鲜文的写字系统、文字系统，所以1446年呢，朝鲜文成为朝鲜王国的官方书写文字。尽管如此，汉字仍然是朝鲜精英阶层的主要书写系统，并持续了500年。
French priest Jean Bassett started to translate the Bible into Chinese in the early 18th century. Unfortunately, he died before he finished the New Testament, and the manuscript was never published. It ended up in the British Library in London, where it was forgotten for a very long time. And eventually, this partial translation was copied and taken back to China by Robert Morrison, a Protestant, Protestant missionary of the London Missionary Society, who used it as the basis of a full, the first full Chinese Bible translation.
我们还需要知道的是，法国的神父，叫做让·巴瑟特，他在18世纪初呢，就开始将圣经翻译成中文。但不幸的是，他在完成新约之前就去世了，所以他的手稿从未出版过。最终被伦敦的大英图书馆收藏，保存在那里，然后遗忘了很长一段时间。最后，来自伦敦的新教宣教士，就是马礼逊了啊，去中国的第一个宣教士，他将这位法国神父的圣经的翻译版本呢，手稿呢，部分手稿复制并带回了中国，并以此为基础呢，完成了第一部完整的中文圣经翻译。
So, the Koreans then owe much to the Chinese scholars who helped translate the Bible with Dr. Robert Morrison and his assistant, William Milne. Only the elite, more scholarly Koreans were able to read the early Christian pamphlets and testaments. And Dr. Morrison was successful in publishing an English-Chinese dictionary. And afterwards, he prepared vocabularies for Korea, Japan, and China. And extensive printing operations were executed in Shanghai, where seven types of sizes, I mean, of Chinese type, beside English, Korean, Manchu, Japanese, Hebrew, and Greek, were cast. This was circa 1854, 1892.
当时的朝鲜人呢，他们非常感激中国的学者帮助马礼逊博士将圣经翻译成汉语。当时参与翻译的还有马礼逊的助手，叫做米莲博士，还有两位中方的中国人也参与了圣经的翻译。当时呢，只有朝鲜精英阶层知识分子，他们才能够阅读这些早期的基督教早期的圣经翻译汉语版本。1835年呢，马礼逊呢，还出版了英汉字典。之后呢，他还将一些词语呢，就是在汉之后呢，他还就建立了就是一些词汇库吧，就是关于为朝鲜、日本和中国建立一些词汇库啊，这些词汇库呢与基督教有关系啊，名词术语。在上海呢，当时有非常大型的印刷行动啊，有非常正规的印刷活动啊，除了英语、韩语、满语、日语、希伯来语和希腊语之外呢。他们还印刷汉语。
A good friend of Morrison, Charles Gutzlaff, worked with the East India Company, and he worked with Dr. Morrison, and he sent a stock of Chinese scriptures and texts which could be read by the educated Koreans. Now, Gutzlaff was a very interesting person because he inspired many people, and he inspired the Welsh missionary that I will talk about later, Robert Germain Thomas, who went initially to China and then eventually lost his life in Korea.
马里逊的一位好朋友叫查尔斯·郭士纳，他呢这个人与东印度公司呢合作，也与马里逊博士合作，他们将一批中文版的圣经呢一些文本寄给那些受过良好教育的朝鲜人阅读。这位郭士纳呢激励了很多人，包括我们今天的要谈到的主人公，就是来自英国威尔士的宣教士罗伯特·杰曼·托马斯。这位我们今天要谈到的主要人物，托马斯宣教士，他从威尔士去了中国，最后呢在朝鲜殉道了。
With the opening up of trade, many missionaries went to China and later Korea. And a few of those names, what I'll give you now, let me see, the Horace Grant Underwood was very important. Samuel Austin Moffat, William Baird, Henry Appenzeller. They went from the US to Korea. They went from the UK to China and later Korea. And Robert Germain Thomas, who the one I mentioned, who actually was a first martyr in Korea, of a Protestant martyr. He also came from the UK. So Morrison also, the translator, was from the UK as well as Gutzlaff. There are lots and lots of names, but they'd be interesting for you to research at some point. Missionaries built much needed hospitals and schools. Korean churches were often built by the Koreans themselves. And monies were raised both in America, Australia, UK, to help with the larger projects such as the hospitals. But it is important to note that the Koreans built and managed their own churches during this period. And the enthusiasm were for the gospel was paramount.
随着中国对国际贸易的开放呢，许多西方宣教士前往中国，其中有些人后来又去了朝鲜。这段时间呢，从英国和美国离开前往远东宣教的人，包括一些著名的人物，例如从美国到朝鲜宣教的。有约翰·尼维斯，1853年他在那建立了教会，还有一些是医生宣教士，还有一些是教育家，例如威廉·贝尔德1891年在朝鲜创办崇实大学。那么从英国到中国，后来又到朝鲜的宣教士呢，包括马里逊。所以马里逊呢，他是翻译圣经的，刚才提到了，就是到中国的第一位宣，也许是马里逊，我也可能重名的啊，这我不太把握，反正叫马里逊啊，他到了中国，也到了韩国，应该不是中国的马里逊。还有一个就是我们今天要谈的主要人物，罗伯特·杰曼·托马斯，他是从威尔士先到中国，后来又到了韩国的。还从澳大利亚前去的，这些西方的宣教士呢，修建了在韩国呢，在朝鲜修建了急需的医院和学校。那么朝鲜的教堂通常由朝鲜人自己建造，那资金呢由美国、澳大利亚和英国筹集，用于帮助大型项目。在此期间呢，需要注意的是，韩国人呢，韩国基督徒在此期间呢。他们不仅建造自己的教堂，还管理自己的教堂，就有这个独立性。 他们对福音的热情呢，是至高无上的啊，极其热情，对福音传播的热情。
British settlements were established under the terms of the Treaty of Nanking following the victory of the First Opium War, 1839-1842, and five treaty ports were opened to foreign merchants. The American and French soon followed, establishing themselves in the North and South, respectively, around the British settlement, as it were.
英国在对中国的第一次鸦片战争获胜之后呢，根据和中国签署的《南京条约》，中国呢开始有5个通商口岸向外国商人开放，然后英国、法国呢紧随其后，分别在中国的北部、南部建立自己的据点，就效法英国了。
I have here a list of the internal conflicts in Korea prior to 1900, and these are only here to show you that the state of Korea and the political state of Korea that the missionaries were entering. They were often entering very dangerous places simply because it was just a very difficult place for foreigners at the time. They were called the Hermit Kingdom. So these are internal conflicts. One which was pretty interesting to me is after the assassination of the Queen in 1895, there were many missionaries that helped the king and were actually making meals for him, etc., to make sure that nobody was going to poison him or anything. So that was particularly interesting, 1895. And then there was the Byongyin persecution, which was the persecution of Catholic priests, which happened in 1866. 1866 was also the time when Robert Germain Thomas was there and was executed. Anyway, the names of the people that were with the king at the time were James Gale, Homer Hilbert, George Jones, Horace Underwood, Appenzeller, and there was also Mrs. Underwood, she was a physician, and she had been the Queen's doctor while she was alive, and they all continued to help the king after the assassination. So they couldn't have been closer to the making of Korean history. And these were the same group of missionaries who throughout the 80s and 90s, a series of Protestant missionaries who began establishing schools and hospitals, setting up printing press, and began translating the Bible.
好，下面我来介绍一下1900年之前在朝鲜王国内部的冲突和动荡第一呢，就是1894年的当时叫东学叛乱了，就朝鲜人民对变革的抵抗与新儒家有关系了。第二呢是引发了当时的，1894年呢还引发了甲午中日战争，因此引发了。第三呢是甲午改革，皇家下令呢要减掉男性的那个发臼，朝鲜用的发臼是中国应该是明朝的那种吧，所以他们当时呢，朝鲜试图引入现代主义，例如放弃阴历，改用西方的公历，1895年呢，还废除了科举制度，那么第1895年呢，还有一件大事情就是，这个皇后被暗杀了，皇后被暗杀， 1897年呢，朝鲜这个王国的高宗皇帝呢，宣布成立大韩帝国，一直持续到1910年日本吞并朝鲜。那么1866年呢，这就是比较早的了啊，应该是列为第一次逼迫了。1866年呢，朝鲜天主教呢，受到严厉的逼迫。1866年，那我们的主人公这个马里逊呢，也就是在那个时期，到达朝鲜，然后被处决的。所以当时呢，这个皇后被暗杀之后呢，1895年皇后被暗杀之后呢，一帮西方宣教士每天晚上都在宫殿里居住，为的是安慰国王啊，减轻国王的恐惧。这包括不少的男的宣教士和女的宣教士，他们夫人James Gare 啊、赫伯特·琼斯等人。其中呢，安德伍德的夫人曾经是这个皇后在世的时候的医生，所以在皇后遇害之后呢，她继续为国王做饭。也就是在这一段特殊的时期呢，这些宣教士非常近距离的参与了韩国历史的创造过程，这是前所未有的。而这些宣教士呢，正是在整个19世纪80年代、90年代，来到从主要从美国了以及英国来到朝鲜，建立学校、医院，建立印刷机、翻译圣经，等等一系列的活动正是这批宣教士，虔诚的宣教士。参与了宫廷的细节。
Oops, sorry, I'm gone. This is a picture of Queen Min, who was killed by the Japanese in 1895. And the persecution of foreigners arose in 1839, 1846, and 1860. And then a second wave of persecution began in 1866 when missionary Robert Jermaine Thomas sailed from China into Korea for the second time and was beheaded along with the captain and crew of the General Sherman. He actually took a student with him, a Chinese student, to help him. And this was the time, as I said, when Korea was called a hermit country, not letting anyone enter except the Chinese to whom they paid tributes. And the West, of course, was aggressively trying to enter countries for trade. But by the latter half of the 19th century, Protestants had made good relationships with the royal family, as I mentioned, attending to the needs of the king after the queen's assassination.
刚才我们提到的1895年，被暗杀的皇后，叫闵皇后，闵皇后，她呢实际上是被日本人暗杀的。那么在朝鲜对外国人的迫害呢，当然包括宣教士了，始于1839年，然后在1846年、1860年，这些呢属于第一次大的逼迫，第二次迫害呢始于1866年，也就是当时呢我们的这个主人公来自威尔士的宣教士罗伯特·杰曼·托马斯，他是第二次从中国坐船到朝鲜，然后登陆后呢，他被朝鲜官方抓住，连同整个当时的船的船长，那个船叫谢尔曼将军，谢尔曼将军后，连同船长和船员一同被斩首，被处决。当时呢，他还带了一位中国的学生和他一同前往帮助他。正如我们前面提到的，因为韩国的精英人士他们懂汉语，当时韩国被称为隐士之国。也就是说，除了中国人之外，其他任何国家的人不可以进入。因为中国呢是他们的宗主国，他们需要向中国进贡每年。 这个时候呢，作为西方呢，就是试图要打开这些亚洲国家的大门进行贸易。所以到了19世纪下半叶啊，我们刚才已经提到了，这些新教徒的宣教士与朝鲜的王室啊、皇室建立了良好的关系，尤其是在1895年19世纪的后半期，在皇后遇刺后，他们进入宫廷生活，照顾国王的需要，关系达到前所未有的密切程度。
Oh, here's something very familiar to myself. My earliest connection to Korea was when I learned of the missionary Robert Jermaine Thomas, who was martyred in Korea. And this is my homeland, and this is Wales, and this is where Robert Jermaine Thomas was born and brought up. And here are the beautiful rolling hills in Wales and many, many sheep. In fact, there are more sheep in Wales than there are people. Would you believe that?
就是我与朝鲜、韩国啊最早的联系呢，是因为我获得了这个知识，历史知识，就是在关于在当时朝鲜殉道的这个传教士，托马斯，也因此呢，让我把注意力呢从中国、韩国转向我的祖国威尔士这是我的故乡，大家看这个图片。我的故乡威尔士有许多美丽的、连绵起伏的山丘，还有许多羊事实上呢，威尔士的羊比人还多啊，你们可能感到难以置信。
Right, here's a map of Wales, and in Wales is the green, England is coloured pink, and Scotland is beyond that. And to the west, of course, you'll find Ireland. So I began my journey of the history of the Korean Christianity with this martyr who gave his life as he attempted to take the gospel from Wales to China and then Korea.
这张地图上你们可以看到，绿色的是我们威尔士，粉红色的是英格兰，苏格兰是那个绿色的后边那一小块，向西呢就是大西洋你会看到爱尔兰岛，爱尔兰。那所以我的韩国的基督教历史之旅呢，始于一位殉道者的故事。就是我们谈到的主人公罗伯特·马里逊，他是我们威尔士人，他试图将耶稣基督的福音呢传到朝鲜，并因此呢殉道丧生。
And this time it was the Industrial Revolution, revolution was happening in Wales. You see, this is there were coal mining industries, steel mining industries, all kinds of things in Wales.
大家看这个照片呢，这是当时威尔士的照片。当时这个是历史时期呢，威尔士刚刚开始工业革命，能看到就是他们煤矿采煤矿这些烟筒，主要是煤矿工业开始。
Here's an example of a coal miner in Wales. Robert Jermaine Thomas was more educated. This would be a man who would not have been educated. He would have been working in the mines, and it was a very, very tough life for him.
这是1850年代在威尔士的煤矿工人。那么我们的主人公，罗伯特·托马斯呢？他是受到良好教育的一位年轻人。那如果他没有受到良好的教育，那么估计他的命运和这些煤矿工人一样，非常的悲惨。
This is a movie, and the movie is of a person that I met. He was the son of a missionary. His name is Dr. Samuel Hugh Moffat. He was the son of one of the first missionaries who stayed in Korea until he was thrown out by the Japanese later. So I'll just put this movie on and you can see and enjoy Samuel Austin Moffat.
我呢，就是他当时正在开始他研究韩国基督教历史的时候呢，他结识了这位萨姆尔莫菲特博士。这位萨姆尔萨莫菲特博士呢，是一位宣教士的儿子。就是他的父亲呢，莫菲特呢，是第一批到达朝鲜宣教的就进入朝鲜嘛啊。成功进入朝鲜宣教的，新教宣教士对，这位莫夫特呢，在
Robert Germain Thomas left Wales on a mission to spread the gospel. He died bringing God's word to Korea.
Man was such a dramatic martyrdom and intense commitment led to the martyrdom. Is worthy of growing into a legend.
这位是就是
Robert Germain Thomas left Wales on a mission to spread the gospel. He died bringing God's word to Korea.
Man was such a dramatic martyrdom and intense commitment led to the martyrdom is worthy of growing into a legend.
就是这位莫菲特博士呢，介绍，在朝鲜殉道的这位我们的主人公罗伯特宣教士这位是基督教历史学家了啊。这位作者有一本关于他对亚洲基督教历史研究比较深，所以 Stella 呢和这个人认识了就在他的帮助下呢，开始了这个朝鲜宣教历史的研究。教会历史的研究。
When I began writing my book, I was privileged to meet Dr. Moffat. He was the son of one of the first missionaries, as I said, and his life really reflected Christ. And I really felt when I met him that I was really catching a flame of the Holy Spirit. It was amazing because his father actually remembers a Bible from that was from the time of Robert Germain Thomas. Missionaries at this time were often men and women who were educated and had financial means. And it's difficult sometimes to think of, you know, what made them leave the luxury of their lives to a country at that particular time had very little to offer. And it was just the love of Christ and the Holy Spirit who had that moved them. They took the news of the crucified and risen Christ, and they believed that everyone should know this Jesus and everyone should know his love. And this is, it was amazing to me learning about meeting this man, because it was a sort of, he was passing on something to me, the baton, as it were, the great news of Jesus Christ. And now he has passed on, and it is my job now to do the same. I'll just go to the
young Welshman.
Oh, sorry, I think that's a repeat.
就是当我开始写这本书的时候呢，就结识了这个莫菲特博士。刚才提到他是曾经在朝鲜宣教士的一位莫菲特的一个传教士的儿子。所以他说呢，这个莫菲特的生平呢，就他的父亲呢，反映了基督的生命了。他说这个莫菲特博士就是他认识这个，也是有如此近前的生命了。通过他呢，对朝鲜半岛，宣教历史呢，有了更深入了解。和他谈话呢，也许和他交流呢，你很容易，被一种圣灵的火焰所点燃吧。 那种典言。我从他那里学到了许多关于这位传教士罗伯特·托马斯的知识。大家知道，当时的西方宣教士呢，他们都受过良好的教育，而且都有相当好的经济能力，也就是对他们来说，前往中国呀、朝鲜去宣教呢，他们需要放弃相对奢侈的生活，到那些非常动荡、贫穷、没有可以给他们提供什么好事情的好东西的国家。那为什么呢？其实就是耶稣基督的爱嘛，和圣灵感动他们的心，他们因此呢，愿意将这个福音好消息，传给其他国家的人，他们认为呢，每个人呢都应该听到耶稣基督的福音，每个人都需要耶稣基督的爱，所以呢，就是说。每个国家每个语言吧，都需要传扬耶稣基督的福音和爱。
Another quick short movie.
My father remembers his visit with Aung San Suu Kyi to the house of a man who probably was one of the executioners of Thomas, that he had taken the Bible at the execution and brought it to his home. And had papered the walls with
it. Praise God. This is the Welshman's Bible from the beach? Thomas's Bible. Praise God.
No more than 这位墨菲特博士刚才说呢，他的父亲，在朝鲜宣教，认识了那位当年处决托马斯的政府官员，正是这位处决托马斯的行刑的人吧，算不上官员，行刑的刽子手吧。他从托马斯的手里接过了那本圣经，然后处决了托马斯。他之后呢，把这本圣经拿回去，用把圣经的每一页纸撕下来，糊在自己家里墙上装饰比较好看一些。然后开始阅读这本托马斯给他的圣经。也就是这位墨菲特博士的父亲呢，认识这位刽子手。
Oh, sorry. Need to go down there. Right, in front of you now. In my research, it was such a wonderful time, finding out and discovering about Thomas and his wife, and how they went to China and Korea, and many things just opened up to me, which I believe were just a matter of answers to prayer. And here in front of me is the marriage registry of Robert Germain Thomas and Caroline Godfrey. And this is, I went to the church where they were married, which is a wonderful, it was a real treasure that I found this for my research. Okay, that's it.
在我研究期间呢，就研究着我们的主人公罗伯特·托马斯的历史的过程中呢，我惊喜地发现了他和他的妻子凯洛琳结婚的这个原始档案登记手册就这个照片中显示的，我非常高兴了，我想这也是上帝对我很多的祷告的回应所以这是他们结婚的1863年，他们在坎蒂什镇，公理教会结婚，这是原始档案记录，他们的结婚登记。
And here is the Palmes. It's a boat called the Palmes, And Robert Jermaine Thomas was an adventurous and ambitious man for the gospel of Christ. He expressed that he wanted to go to the uttermost part of the world, and which we now know ended in Korea. And his wife Caroline would meet with death. But this is the actual boat that he went on in 1863.
这个船只呢，正是1866年吧。或者是就是罗伯特这位宣教士，他第一次去朝鲜啊，坐了一艘船，啊不是坐着去朝鲜了，去中国啊。1863年，乘坐这艘船去了中国。我们的主人公这个罗伯特·托马斯宣教士呢，他愿意为耶稣基督的福音而冒险，啊，他想去最遥远的地方这个世界，那我们后来知道就是朝鲜了，朝鲜的，
This here is the home of Caroline Godfrey, his wife. This is where she grew up in Northamptonshire. And she had five brothers. She was the only daughter. And she went, you know, an excited mother, an excited wife, going to a new country to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. And little did she know that it was... During her first year in Korea, she lost her life, dying of a miscarriage. And this miscarriage was brought on by learning that a missionary friend of hers had also died of a miscarriage. So can you imagine what the family must have felt? You know, she had left so excited and to serve her God, and she did not last 1 year and died during this because of a miscarriage. We have the privilege of hindsight and can see that despite death and destruction, the Lord was going to use their lives. For those still alive, the parents and family, it must have been a very difficult time.
这位呢是罗伯特·托马斯的妻子凯罗琳，当时居住的家，在北安普顿啊，在这个家里长大，这是这个他们的这个住房，他有五个兄弟啊，他是家里的独生女，但是去中国的第一年呢，他到达上海几个月后呢，他和丈夫到达罗伯特到达上海，罗伯特·托马斯到达上海几个月后呢。就因为流产而丧生，因为难产流产而死亡，所以可以想象他们父母的他这位唯一女儿的父母还有兄弟们的感受了啊，所以我们呢，如今呢能很有幸了、啊、能够看到，尽管有这些死亡与这些伤害，上帝仍然用了他们的生命。用了他们的生命啊，去做事，用他们的生命去做事，但是对于当时活着人来说，亲属来说，那一定是非常艰难、难以接受的一种现实。
This is no fairy tale, and we have records to prove. Even, this is a diary here of the Marquis Lafayette Wood, and they were on the mission field, and his wife was the other wife that died. And this is a recording of his diary. And in his diary, he said that by all accounts, after learning of his wife's death, Caroline Godfrey or Mrs. Jermaine Thomas had her miscarriage, her misfortune.
所以这不是一个童话故事了啊！我们有书面的原始记录啊，这是伍德侯爵啊爵士在1864年在上海写的日记啊，在这个日记中呢，他说明了罗伯特·托马斯的妻子凯洛琳因为流产而去世，而在他流产去世之前呢。 就得知了这位伍德侯爵的妻子也因为流产而去世，这都是宣教士了啊。
So here we have Hanover Chapel. This is in Wales. Robert Jermaine Thomas preached his first sermon here, which was called Yesterday, Today, Forever, Jesus is the Same. His father was a minister here, and he was a participant in the, it's called the Welsh David Morgan-led revival. So there were revivals in 1855. And in 1903 to 1904, Wales experienced a global revival led by Evan Roberts. At this time, the Holy Spirit also used a visitor from Wales, to Wales from America, a Reverend Howard Agnew Johnson, to take this flame of revival to India, China, and eventually Korea. And you may know a little bit about the Great Pyong Revival, which Pyongyang Revival in North Korea, which took place in 1907. And there were thousands who began making a commitment to serve Christ. And this period of time, this certainly strengthened the growth of Christianity in Korea. Now, the political impact of this was that 19 dedicated Christians were signers of the Declaration of Independence from Japan, which had annexed the country in 1910. So it was just before the annexation, which gave Christians much strength. And so during the Japanese occupation from 1907 to 1945, there was much persecution of Christians in Korea. And many Korean pastors were imprisoned and persecuted because of their affiliation to an independent Korea and also following the Christian faith.
这是罗伯特，我们的主人公罗伯特·托马斯的父亲，担任牧师的教堂啊，就是汉诺威礼拜堂，位于英国威尔士的一个小村庄啊，就在汉诺威，这也是呢罗伯特·托马斯第一次讲道的地方。他当时讲道的题目是“昨天、今天，直到永远，耶稣基督都是一样的，不变的。”那么威尔士呢，是一个非常神奇的新教小国啊，它的影响力不可忽略。例如，托马斯的父亲呢，曾经参与了1855年威尔士一位叫摩根领导的复兴运动，所以威尔士呢是非常神奇的地方。1855年大复兴，然后1903到1904年呢，威尔士又经历了有罗伯茨领导的一种复兴，一个基督教大复兴。这次复兴之火呢，点燃了全球的复兴大火，从威尔士开始，因为威尔士有很多到访者基督教的到访者，基督徒，所以这到访者呢，他们回到自己的国家呢，将这个复兴的火焰呢带回了自己的国家。例如，来自美国的一位访客，叫做霍华德·约翰逊牧师，他就将这次威尔士的复兴大火，带回到了美国。好像是洛杉矶开始吧，那还有人带回了印度、中国，最后呢，威尔士这场复兴大火、复兴基督教复兴之火呢，到达了韩国，带到了韩国，所以1907年1月呢，就发生了著名的平壤大复兴，成千上万的朝鲜人承诺要服侍耶稣基督，所以这次平壤大复兴呢，也是源自威尔士复兴。无疑加强了什么？朝鲜基督教的发展和历史。那这次复兴呢，在朝鲜呢还产生了许多社会影响力，包括政治影响力。这次政治影响力就包括有19名近前的基督徒政治家，他们签署了独立宣言，宣布脱离1910年吞并韩国的日本。但在1907年呢， 那不是，就是1910年呢，就是说，就脱离日本。那在一呃脱离，1910年嘛，吞并韩国。在1907和1945年这个日本占领期间呢，朝鲜基督徒受到了日本官方的严重的逼迫。许多朝鲜牧师，因为与独立后的朝鲜有联系而被监禁和迫害。就是朝鲜当时部分独立嘛，独立。
This is Samuel Hugh Moffat again, and just with a map of Pyongyang. So that, yeah, just that. And the Pyongyang revival was in 1907. But we were in his home and having a great time learning about North Korea. Well, actually, it was Korea. It was not divided at that time, was it? There was no South and North. It was all Korea. But this is him explaining his map.
当时我和丈夫拜访麦菲特博士啊，历史学家了。他当时指着一幅平壤的地图，老地图，告诉我们啊，1907年当时的平壤大复兴啊。而当时1907年的时候呢，朝鲜还是完整统一的啊，还没有分成南北。
There's a Korea, another picture of Korea, and that would have been at the time when 1890s.
这是大约1890年的朝鲜的一张照片。
Sort of main high street. So this is a brief, Thomas died when he was 27 years old. So when you research somebody, you only have 27 years, but in that 27 years, he did a lot of different things. So here's the outline of his life, is right in front of you. 1863, he arrives in Shanghai with his wife. 1864, his wife Caroline dies of a miscarriage. And because of this, in 1864 to 65, he decides to leave the missionary society and is employed at the customs office in Yantai, or Chefu, as it was then. 1865, he took his first missionary journey from China to Korea. 1866, his secondary mission journey from China to Korea. And sadly, another Chinese student went with him and to help with the interpretation. And he would have been on that same boat, which lost all the crew. September the 6th, 1866, Robert Germain Thomas is beheaded in Suk Island, an island in the Taedong River, Pyongyang, Korea.
那么下面我们简单总结，介绍一下我们主人公托马斯宣教士的生平。他于1863年呢到达上海和妻子凯洛琳。那1864年3月，他的妻子凯洛琳因流产而去世。1864到1865年呢，他离开了伦敦宣教协会，在中国的烟台海关任职，然后1865年呢，他从中国第一次乘船前往朝鲜宣教，1866年呢，第二次从中国前往朝鲜宣教，所以呢，在1866年的9月6号，1866年的9月6号，在第二次前往朝鲜宣教的时候呢。托马斯宣教士和那艘船的船长以及船员，在平壤大同江的宿岛被朝鲜政府抓获，全部斩首。
This is another piece in research. This is his letter of resignation to the Customs Department, Chefu. before he left for his second missionary journey.
啊，这是我们发现的一个原始文件，啊，就是1865年，托马斯向中国烟台海关递交的辞职信。啊，他辞去职务之后呢，才第二次呢，前往朝鲜传教。
So before Thomas went in, he goes as a translator on the General Sherman. That was the boat that he went in on his second missionary journey. It was a trading ship. And Thomas's purpose was to take Bibles into Korea because he had met Catholic Koreans who did not have Bibles. So he worked along with the Scottish Bible Society to secure Chinese script Bibles to take up the river. And at that time, Koreans obviously were ordered not to have anything to do with foreign traders. And it was at the risk of death or imprisonment that Koreans should read literature from these foreign interlopers. But there were brave Koreans who wanted to reach out to other countries and who wanted to learn more about what the foreigners were about. So there is so much written about this incident. It was the British were going in there a little bit aggressively and arrogantly. But after much discord, the captain and the crew and the passengers, as well as Thomas, were killed.
那么托马斯为什么从中国烟台海关辞职呢？是因为当时的他遇到一位来自朝鲜的天主教徒，朝鲜天主教徒告诉他呢，他们需要圣经。听到这个消息呢，他就辞职了。他辞职呢，第二次出使朝鲜呢，乘坐谢尔曼将军号英国商船。他乘坐这艘船呢，作为翻译，他的角色是做翻译。当然，他的目的是将圣经呢带到朝鲜，带到朝鲜。他与苏格兰圣经协会合作，获得了中文版圣经。所以这艘船呢，他们沿着河航行。因为他知道呢，受过良好教育以及韩国的精英，他们是阅读汉语中国文字没任何问题，所以呢，他带去很多汉语圣经、中文圣经。当时呢，韩国下令呢，韩国的本国人不得与外国商人有任何来往，也不可以阅读来自外国的作品文字。那么惩罚要么是关监狱，要么是处死。但是呢，有一些勇敢的韩国人呢，他们希望了解外边的世界啊，希望了解这些外国人的他们的事情。那么关于这次全船人士被处决的事件呢，有很多记载了从这记载中我们能看到，英国当时的这个船长非常傲慢，也非常自大，他坚持要继续航行，要深入朝鲜。所以呢，经过与他们与朝鲜的官方呢多次发生争执，导致事件升级白热化。最后，朝鲜将船长、船员、乘客，还有我们的主人公托马斯宣教士，全部处决。
Sometimes we see so much difficulty and sacrifice of the people who want to serve Christ, and we might be tempted to say, "Where are you, God?" But Ecclesiastes 3:11 reassures us that God has made everything beautiful in its own time. And one of the early church fathers, Tertullian, coined the term, "The blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church." And so many Korean martyrs, as well as foreign missionaries, sowed the seed, and we are now seeing the harvest.
有的时候呢，我们看到那些服侍基督的人，经历如此多的艰难啊、痛苦和牺牲，我们会忍不住问啊，那上帝在哪里呢？但是传道书啊，3章11节啊，向我们说，那上帝在他的时候啊，做一切美好的事情，正如啊，公元20世纪早期教会的教父之一特土良说的那句著名的话嘛，啊，殉道者的血是教会的种子。因此呢，许多韩国本土的殉道士，还有外国宣教士的殉道士，啊，他们播下了这种种子，教会的种子。如今呢，我们看到了这些种子的成果。
Robert Jermaine Thomas, though, is not forgotten by Koreans or subsequent missionaries who follow in his footsteps. In this photograph, you see they're meeting to build a church to memorialize Thomas. This was also destroyed, but yet there are those who will continually be remembered. They remember those who have fallen because of their faith in their maker.
所以托马斯宣教士呢，也没有被遗忘。朝鲜基督徒还有后来的西方宣教士，都追随他的脚步。大家看这张照片，摄于1928年，就在大同江的树岛，平壤大同江的树岛，就是他被斩首的地方。在这里呢，他们后来啊，当时照片中还没有。他们后来在这里建立了什么？托马斯教会，就是纪念托马斯的教会。建立这个教堂来永远的纪念他。当然，这个教堂后来被日本人给毁掉了。
So here are pictures of early evangelists who also took up their cross to follow Jesus. And their names are here. I'm not sure if I'm saying them correctly, but Su Sung Yun, Pak Hong Chun, Choi Myong Oh. And these were early evangelists that worked in the Thomas Memorial Church.
这三位朝鲜本地的基督徒，他们是最早的三位服侍这个他们所建立的这个托马斯教堂教会的三位神职人员他们的名字我作为翻译者没有找到汉语对应的第一个应该是姓素什么，第二个是汉语中应该是什么朴吧，朴对。第三个是姓崔啊，崔，第一个姓薛，可能啊，没找到，
Here is the picture of the church in North Korea. It was Korea, but it was in Pyongyang. Thomas Memorial Church, 1932. This was before it was destroyed.
这就是那个。他们当地建立的托马斯纪念教堂，在平壤大同江的宿岛，这张照片呢摄于1932年，当然在之后的朝鲜战争中呢就被摧毁了。
Here is the congregation in that church. This was given to me by Samuel Hugh Moffat, this picture. God is the lover of every nation, isn't he, and every soul. And he will put it into your heart, the path you should take. And this is what happened with me. While teaching at Gordon College, my husband brought me home a little story that I would research and eventually publish. So this story we now use as a way to share Christ with many people. And I think that's the next, I'll just go to the next one. Here's the books here. The picture on the frontispiece is an artist's rendition of the execution of Thomas on the bank of the Taedong River. So, this story that I wrote about was a story that brought me to learn more about missionaries and how they sacrificed their lives and how amazing these people were. I was amazed by all the people that I met and how I, when I learned of Robert Germain Thomas's story. So this is the book. These are the frontispieces of the two books here, one in Korean and the other in English.
刚才呢，那个照片呢是托马斯教会内部崇拜的照片啊，挤满了人，也是1932年拍摄的，在被毁掉之前。我们可以看到呢，上帝确实同样爱每个国家和每个灵魂了，每个民族每个灵魂了，上帝爱每个民族每个灵魂了。上帝呢会把我们当走的路呢放在我们的心里。我和丈夫在哥尔顿大学教书的时候呢，我的丈夫呢有一次回家带给我了一个故事，就是他听到了这个托马斯的故事，我就开始研究这个故事呢，直到最终出版，大家看这个照片，左边这个是英文版的，上面的封面插图呢是当代的艺术家。对于托马斯在那个在江边在岸边被处决的场景的再现，那右边这个是我的书翻译成了韩文，翻成韩文，那作为译者呢，我顺便说一下，他的书呢也在10年前，被翻译成汉语，其中主要是由我们学术使命群的一位姊妹，她当时她现在中国了，姓杨的姊妹。他翻译的，然后我对内容进行了校订和，对他翻译内容进行了校订和审核，最终出版了汉语的，当然现在汉语版呢，现在暂时他，没有货，所以呢，如果将来最近会我们处理，希望他能够卖吧，卖以后呢，我们会在群里发出通知，英文版的亚马逊上还是有。可以直接购买啊！我会把链接等一会提供给大家啊。所以呢，因此呢，我和我丈夫呢也将托马斯的事迹呢，传讲给别人，作为我们来分享耶稣基督福音的一种方式。
My husband wanted to sort of travel in the footsteps of Thomas. He admired him and wanted to see what this man was about and what he and wanted to learn about his life and what he did for Christ. And in this journey of both my husband and myself, we spent much time in North Korea, in South Korea. And then eventually we moved to Wales from America. We were living in America initially. When I started writing the book, I was teaching writing. And then we moved to the UK, and we purchased the boyhood home of Robert Germain Thomas. So we had the opportunity to renovate this. It was in a very poor state. So we were very happy that we had the means to be able to do this.
之后呢，因为对这本书写作的过程中呢，研究过程中呢。我当时是在美国写这本书的，因为当时我在高等大学教书，之后呢，我们去了北朝鲜，还有南朝鲜很多次，我们在这个研究的过程中，后来2011年呢，我和丈夫呢就搬回了威尔士，英国威尔士，我们当时有机会买下了这位托马斯宣教士的童年故居，在 Hanover。但当时买下来这个故居呢，已经非常破败了，所以呢，我们就把它翻修了。当然，这个照片呢，并不是这个房子本身，这照片呢是房子旁边的存放谷物的谷仓。对， 当时房子还没翻修啊，我们就买下来并翻修了住房。
So having learned so much, having spoken to so many Koreans and seeing the sacrifice of the Korean Christians, seeing the sacrifice of many missionaries, it was amazing to learn about them. Some missionaries went one day and died because of various circumstances. So there has been much suffering within the body of the Koreans. And I must say, I feel like this. I'll just read this verse from Hebrews 12, 1 to 3. Since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, all these people, let us lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. My husband and I are at the end of our race, but we hope to go a few more miles. But we hope to pass on this baton. In a race, we've passed the baton to the next person. And I hope that maybe some of you listening will be able to catch the fire, catch the baton, and learn of Christ and let the Lord direct your paths to bring others to himself.
我每次想到。耶稣基督在朝鲜的肢体，他们在历史中还有宣教士，他们受了这么多的苦难，受了这么多的逼迫，有时我在想的时候，我就读希伯来书12章1到3节，说，既然我们被这么多的见证人包围着，就让我们放下一切重担，脱去紧紧缠绕我们的罪。以坚韧的心奔跑那摆在我们前头的路程，仰望为我们信心创始成终的耶稣。他因那摆在前面的喜乐，就轻看羞辱，忍受了十字架的苦难，便坐在上帝宝座的右边。他已经在我们前面行了。我和我丈夫呢，所以这是一场。基督徒宣教士，这是一场，仿佛是一场跑步比赛，就像保罗说的一样，是赛跑啊，向着标杆奔跑。我和我丈夫呢，已经接近尾声，已经快跑到了终点了，当然我们希望再多跑几英里了。我们也希望呢，将接力棒或者这个火把呢，传递给像你们这样的人们，像你们这样的基督徒们。愿主耶稣基督指引你们的道路，带领别人归向他。
So we've had many students come to visit us now at this house that we're living in, this home, and among them many Korean students. And one of the students from Cardiff, a Korean student from Cardiff, did this art piece, and it's Robert Jermaine Thomas, done in barley seed. And there's a light behind showing the Christ. So the barley seed represents the seeds that he sowed in Korea and in China, and the light that he followed, the light of Jesus Christ.
This from North Korea. The author is the author of this painting from South Korea.
It's no, it's from
North.
a Korean student who
Yeah.
was studying in Cardiff. So Korean, South Korean student.
Okay. 这是一位来我们威尔士卡蒂夫学习艺术的韩国学生。他参观那个教堂的时候，带来了他制作的那个托马斯的肖像。 它是用种子啊，用一颗种子制作的，代表着福音的种子。在画的后边呢，它用灯光来表示啊，把耶稣基督的形象啊，表示耶稣基督的形象，还有光来表示呢。托马斯的目的就是要将基督的福音带到中国啊，韩国。
Here we have, this is where Thomas Germain, Robert Germain Thomas was born, which is a little bit further. This is the house, we live in the house he was brought up in. But in Rhyadr, this is where he was born. And I'll go to the next slide. It shows you that Koreans have come with us to celebrate the life of Robert Germain Thomas. And there are many Koreans now in Wales, bringing the message of Christ to us. And this was a delightful, wonderful day when we all went out and we put a plaque on the top of, in this church where, or the house where Robert Germain Thomas was born.
这是托马斯宣教士出生的房子，所以上面有个牌子表示纪念。我们买下来并居住的这个房子，就是他现在讲课的这个房子。现在这房子里是托马斯长大的房子啊，不是出生的房子。大家看这个出生的房子呢，我们当时本地人和一些来自于韩国的基督徒们，来这里纪念他，所以托马斯呢是要将福音传到朝鲜。但如今呢，我们看到这些韩国的基督徒来到我们这里，要把福音带给我们，这是何等美好、令人高兴的事情。就是韩国人又现在向他们开始宣教。
So here we have, so we're evangelizing from Wales now. Many people, many Koreans come, many missionaries come from here, and they want to come, they want to pray, and they want to remember the story of Thomas, which encourages them on their journeys. And so this is a guest book from the church, and all the different people signed it.
这是有很多来到我们家，离我们现在居住的房子很近的那个教堂，就是托马斯父亲那个教堂，有很多韩国人来参观，韩国基督徒，所以呢，这是为他们预备的留言簿，让他们签名，让大家看一下，这是他们参观者的签名，相当于朝圣客了。
Okay, many missionaries and others gave their lives to bring the good news of Jesus Christ and to people throughout the world. And Paul was aware of this, and he says, I'm quoting from the scripture, for we who are alive are always being given over to death for Jesus' sake, so that his life may also be revealed in our mortal body. So then he is saying, death is at work in us, but life is at work in you. Just as Jesus gave his life, as it were, for our lives, so the missionaries and those others have given their life for those around them.
因为在过去历史中，许多宣教士还有基督徒都献出了自己的生命，为的是将耶稣基督的福音带给全世界的人们。那么，使徒保罗在写《哥林多后书》4章11节的时候，明显知道意识到清楚这样的事情他说：“因为我们这活着的人，是常为耶稣被交于死地。”使他的生在我们这必死的身上显明出来。这样看来，死是在我们身上发动，生却在你们身上发动。
This is an example I mentioned earlier. Students came to Cambridge from North Korea. So that was a wonderful time. They were studying here in London, and we had a day out with them. And this is the founder, Kim Ching-kyung, of the Pust and Yust universities. So we've had lots of opportunities. And this is just one example of just being alongside students, alongside North Koreans, as well as South Koreans, and trying to show them love. That's it, I think.
这张照片呢是两位来自北朝鲜的学生，他们在剑桥大学读书。他们呢被邀请来到威尔士学习啊，然后他们到达剑桥去读书啊。中转了一下啊，中间这个人呢是个韩国人啊，南朝鲜就是啊，这两位学生是北朝鲜的。这位叫金叫金什么名字啊？我忘了名字了。他呢，就是等于是，创办了，就是在当代啊，创办了在北朝鲜的那个平壤科技大学啊，在当时是，就金正日执政的时候，对，创办了科技大学，所以这是两位学生，所以就是我们，我丈夫呢，就是他说他的丈夫呢，我丈夫和我有。我们曾经在朝鲜工作嘛，很多机会把他们带到威尔士来，我们就在这表达对他们的爱，对他们的接纳。
I'm going to just say about the next slide before it comes. The next slide is a Welsh opera singer. He's singing in Korean, and he is singing that beautiful song, "I am coming, Lord." Coming now to thee, wash me, cleanse me in the blood that flows on Calvary. This was a revival song written in 1872. And Hugh Priday is singing in Korean with a Welsh male voice choir. And we'll go to it now.
我们现在马上要看一个视频。
Miss this one. This is the punting down the Cambridge.
这是那几位学生和那个。大学创办人他们在剑桥大学的河里啊划船。
Right, we'll go to the next.
下面马上放一个视频啊，是威尔士的一个合唱团唱的，用韩语用朝鲜语唱的一首圣歌啊，主啊我来了，现在来到你的身边啊，用加略山的鲜血洗净我吧。
I'm trying to get the movie to work. Oh, it didn't work. Try now. Oh, that was a nice ending for Hugh Priday singing in both Korean and Welsh, actually. And you saw some pictures there of the revival, many, many Koreans who had come to the Lord, some pictures of North Korea that were given to us by the missionary Samuel Moffitt's son. And we've had such great privilege of learning from those who were there and touching the garment, as it were, touching their fire. And I do pray that you'll catch the fire too. Shall I introduce my husband now? Or?
Yes, let me translate first. Okay. 威尔士语啊唱的啊，所以就是说我在莫菲特博士呢得知了比较详细的这些韩国宣教士托马斯的事迹之后呢，我被圣灵的火焰所感染所点燃，我希望圣灵的火焰也能点燃你们这些听众啊。下面我要介绍我的丈夫啊，斯蒂凡普莱斯。 Yes, please.
Hello.
Join us now.
It's a long program. It's a wonder all your students are not asleep.
All right.
And how about Stephen is going to read your bio in Chinese, then Li Kai is going to read that in English to introduce you. Then you can speak to us.A little bit, yeah.
thank you, Mrs. Price, for your very insightful academic lecture. The lecture very inspired me. Let's move on to the next part of the discussion. May I introduce your husband first by Chinese? 非常感谢丽拉普莱斯女士的高质量、高水准的学术讲座。我相信很多人都受到了很大的鼓舞。下面是我们讨论和问答的时间。大家待会可以把问题打到留言区。我先对这个普莱斯女士的丈夫啊，斯蒂芬普莱斯医学博士做个简单的介绍。斯蒂芬普莱斯博士出生于威尔士，1969年毕业于英国布里斯托大学。他的职业是家庭医生和急诊医生。他职业生涯的最后20年呢，开始在世界各地的战争和自然灾害中从事志愿服务。他也是在马赛诸塞州高登大学的校医，在那边担任了22年的校医。自2008年以来，他多次前往中国和朝鲜，从事医学教育和残疾人护理的工作。斯蒂凡和斯特拉普莱斯夫妇都被任命为延边科技大学的兼职教授，斯蒂凡教授还被任命为平壤科技大学的兼职教授。普莱斯博士的基督教信仰一直是他生命旅程的原动力。
Okay, and I will also read the bio in English. Welcome to join us, Stephen Price. Dr. Stephen is a native of Wales.Dr. Steve Price graduated from the University of Bristol, England in 1969. His life work was a family physician and emergency medical doctor, and for the last 20 years of his career, he undertook voluntary service throughout the world during war and natural disasters. He was the college physician at Gordon College,Massachusetts for 22 years. Since 2008, he has made many trips to China and North Korea in the role of teaching medical education and caring for disabled persons. Both Steve and Stella were made adjunct professors at Yanbian University of Science and Technology, and Steve at Pyongyang University of Science and Technology.Dr. Price's Christian faith has been his empowerment through life. All right, so Gawei and actually Mark Sean, would you like to respond? Or actually, let Stella introduce her husband, Steve.
I'll introduce you?
Yeah.
Oh, well, it's been a long time. We've been married for 57 years.
我们结婚57年了。
Pardon?
I'm translating.
Oh, sorry. As we've been married for 57 years.
我们结婚57年了。
We have three children.
我们有3个孩子。
Very big children now.
他们都是很大孩子。
And my husband mostly has been a physician, and I think your interest might be in his time in North Korea, especially. I think there was some interest earlier in questions about North Korea. He's traveled into North Korea doing various, helping in various ways, and we've also been able to have exchange students over here. So we've had a great interest and love for the North Korean people. They are amazingly wonderful people. And we've been, you know, so I'm introducing my husband. Hang on.
Yeah.
So I think he should tell you about his North Korean perhaps experiences. Yeah.
Yeah, 我的丈夫呢, 是个职业医生。但是他的后半生的大部分时间，都用在了，就是等于是帮助朝鲜吧。他经常去朝鲜，去用不同的方式对那里提供帮助。我想大家，对我丈夫的兴趣，我想主要是集中在与朝鲜有关的事情上吧。所以，好，这是我简单的翻译啊。
Yeah. Well, it has been a surprise to me just to see how the Holy Spirit has led me to a new world from a short visit to a little chapel here in Wales. I knew nothing about China, nothing about Thomas, nothing about Korea. Although I grew up just 3 miles down the road from the church, I passed it many times, but never went in. But when I went into the little chapel, the Holy Spirit changed the direction of my life.
我的一次对这个教堂的造访改变了我的人生啊！圣灵通过这次我对这个教堂第一次的拜访，就是托马斯他父亲的教堂，带领我进入了一个全新的世界了。事实上我出生的地方呢，离这个教堂只有几英里了，但我从来没有到过的教堂，也从来没有听说过托马斯的事迹，也就是圣灵的安排了。让我人生发生转变，因为这次意外的造访。
I had made many trips, voluntary medical trips during war, both in the Congo in Africa, the Kosovo war in Serbia and Kosovo, hurricanes in Katrina in Louisiana, and earthquake in Bangladesh. And cyclones in Pakistan, cyclone in Bangladesh. But God changed my direction to China and North Korea.
在那之前呢，我参与了国际上许多的人道救援工作，作为医生，提供医疗援助，例如刚果的内战，科索沃的战争。还有有些地方呢，我们说孟加拉那种什么海啸了，还有巴基斯坦的地震啊，等等等等。但这次拜访这个教会呢，彻底改变了我的人生的轨道。
I'd come back from the earthquake in serving in the earthquake in Pakistan, which was a very severe earthquake, and came to this little church, found out about Thomas.Went back to America and said, Stella, there's an amazing story of a faithful young man and his wife. We must know more about it. So she began her research.
我当时呢，从巴基斯坦，当时严重的地震嘛，救灾之后，回到威尔士，然后拜访那个教会，才发现了有托马斯宣教士这样的事迹。然后我就回到美国，赶紧告诉我的妻子 Stella。 啊，就说有这样一个奇妙的人物，奇妙的故事，所以，于是事情就从此开始了。
I wanted to follow in the footsteps of Thomas to learn about how and why he loved this people. Why would he sacrifice his life? Why would his young wife die in serving Jesus? I
want 我想呢，追寻他们的脚踪，我想追寻宣教士托马斯的脚踪。我想明白为什么他，如此的爱这个，朝鲜，为什么他们就是甘愿献身，为什么他的妻子就是就是流产去世，就是他们为了什么做出大的牺牲？所以我想追寻研究他的脚踪啊，明白这些事情。
When we begin a journey, God sends his people alongside us. And I'm very grateful for my dear brother, Mark Shan, who opened up a new understanding of China to me, and then Dr. Moffat for North Korea, and then President Kim, the founder of the university in Yanbian, China, and also then in North Korea. So these people were alongside helping me to understand, to love, and to move ahead.
在这个过程中呢，有这样的几个人物呢，促进并帮助了我对这些事情的对这些探寻这些事情的原因，其中包括那位历史学家墨菲特历史学家，还有包括马克善他对中国基督教情况的介绍。还有那位建立平壤科技大学以及延边大学的，韩国的基督徒，这些人呢，都在这过程中，促进了我对这些事情的理解。
Initially, I joined a group that were working in North Korea called Wheat Mission, and in several visits, we undertook a lot of surgery. Amazing surgery. We had one, we had several children that we put cochlear implants. They'd never heard their mother speak. And one of our team was able to do that operation. Another team repaired a lip deformity, hair lip. We showed that there was such a wonderful relationship with the doctors and the nurses in the hospitals and many hospitals opened up to us in North Korea.
我第一次去朝鲜呢，是加入了一个自愿援助民间组织了医疗组织。我们到达朝鲜，我们实施了许多奇妙的手术，包括一个小孩，我们在他的耳朵里植入了什么东西设备仪器吧，他就能听到他母亲的声音了，从来没听到。例如我们去做手术，校正一些小孩的兔唇。他们生来就是嘴唇那个唇嘛，兔唇。我们和当地的医生和护士建立了非常美好的关系。
I found that the disabled people in North Korea were often shunned and not bothered with because they couldn't contribute to the communist state and the work. So they were pushed to one side. But the team of people I work with change that whole dynamic.
包括一些朝鲜的残疾人啊，他们社会的边缘群体，因为他们不能够为共产主义社会做出贡献啊，所以他们就等于是一群无用的人。但是我们呢，What's your last sentence again?
So God sent alongside me professors of physical therapy to help with children's deformities. We had Brazilian soccer players who taught the deaf to play soccer and even the blind to play goal ball, which is like a bell inside a ball. We went to deaf schools, blind schools, places normally no one would be allowed to go to.
所以就是我们和这医疗组织呢，我们的医疗志愿者。包括教授呢，我们到达朝鲜帮助他们，就是说，做手术，解决小孩残疾的问题，还有残疾的问题，还有盲， 我们还去了盲人学校，啊，就一般人没办法接触的东西。例如，我们还带来了那个巴西的一个球员，著名球星，啊，到那去和他们踢足球，就是我们深入接触了许多外人不可能有的机会。
The wonderful blessing was too that I helped with another colleague start a medical school in Pyongyang, North Korea.
啊，另外我想分享的是我和另外一个，我帮助另外一个同事，我们在平壤建立了平壤的医学院，对。
We had 16 medical students, and at the end of the several-week course, they said, "Now we want to be doctors. We know why we want to serve our people."
我们有第一批的16个朝鲜学生，当这个短期的课程结束之后，他们都纷纷表示，他们愿意成为医生，愿意服务于人民。
Sadly, I've learned this in life. Whenever we step forward for Christ, there's opposition. And then within a short while, COVID happened, and also North Korea veered politically much more towards Russia. And the sad history is our medical school at this point in time is closed.
我学到了一个重要的功课是，当我们在做这些试工的时候，就有许多障碍会出现嘛，困难会出现，就当我们的试工正是一片良好的时候，进行的非常好的时候，疫情也开始了，然后北朝鲜的新的领导人呢，也政治上更加强硬，在关系上，国际关系上更加靠近俄罗斯，所以呢，试工就现在就停下了，
The summary is darkness cannot keep out the light. And as I believe the North Korea, and even I pray much for China because I know our brothers and sisters there are even more difficulty, especially in Mark's area of Northwest China. But you know what? We're on the winning side. And with that, I'll just finish. And if there are any questions, I'd be pleased. One blessing I had was to visit Sumsuk Island where Thomas lay buried. His grave is unmarked, but I know where it is. I know exactly where it is. And one day we'll celebrate his life with a memory stone and we'll remind this world of God's faithfulness.
但是呢，我相信黑暗无法拒绝光明。我也为就是朝鲜的基督徒，还有中国的基督徒祷告啊，他们都政治上受到很大的压力啊，处境很不好。我去过托马斯宣教士遇难的那个地方啊，他的坟墓墓地啊，他的墓碑啊，我们有一次在那去纪念他，我们在那纪念他。我立刻帮我一下，最后一句话想不起来了，他说什么？
Are there any
你
questions?
开一下啊，立刻说一下，最后一句是什么忘了？他说是看到墓地纪念碑啊，墓碑他们。
对，他说他要，这个提醒全世界，这个我们的这个上帝的信仰。他说。
哦，好，谢谢。那所以我就简单回忆一下，继续咱们的程序吧啊。那我用汉语啊，非常感谢Stella 和 Steven，今天出现在我们的讲座中，用他们的讲座和他们的见证鼓励我们啊。我认识他们10多年，从认识开始，后来发生了一系列事，也是我作为基督徒经历的许多奇妙见证之一吧，并且这个上帝的这种安排，我和他们奇妙的认识，神迹般的这种过程吧，我相信应该是有后话的，但似乎看起来就没有什么后话，但应该是有后话。我们知道，像传道书他举的例子，上帝有他的时间了，所以我想，作为中国许多基督徒呢， 也有责任了解一些周边国家地区的基督教历史，看看上帝主耶稣基督在不同的民族、不同的历史、不同语言、环境中所做的新事情。以赛亚说的做了新事，为此非常感谢上帝，也为Steven 和 Stella 夫妇呢，真是感谢上帝，以上帝的荣美，通过他们手中的弓显现出来。正如诗篇90，也希望他们的功能够继续在新的一代人中接力。愿上帝建立新的一代人在东亚的所从事的耶稣基督的福音的事工。好，我就简单回应。
谢谢大家。今天是我们这学期最后一次讲座了，我们就明年再见了。特别感谢大家。